First, thank you for joining the session. Second, apologies for my recent flu that broke my voice. And third, I'm getting lots of people, so I'm actually getting stage fright for the first time in many years. So thanks for joining. Lots of people, make yourself comfortable. We are going to discuss workflows, how to get workflows on FHIR, which is something that FHIR has introduced over the last 2 or 3 years. Before that, let me have a quick show of hands. Who is doing more functional than technical work here? Who is doing more technical than functional? Anyone doing more clinical than any of those? No, so we have functional and technical people. That's actually very cool. First of all, who am I? I'm a consulting. I'm working, well, independently, but now I'm associated with IMEC in Belgium. I'm originally from Portugal, but I've been living in Belgium for 10 years now. I started as an implementer many years ago in Portugal, and then more recently in Belgium for several projects. And one of the areas that was always tricky to manage was the area of workflows. We'll see some of the nuances there. And then while doing that, I volunteer for working with standards organizations, HL7, IHE, ISO, also a bit of DICOM, and have a particular focus on healthcare operational side. So not on the clinical side, where I'm not the strongest mind in the groups, but the operational side, which is very much, in my opinion, put as a second priority. So we all want to make the best clinical models, but business must run operationally. So I feel that we also owe some focus on the operational side. So why do we have workflows on FHIR? First of all, why do we need to work on workflows if all the clinical data is already exposed, if we have all the data looking the same? As you are doing implementation, you will know that it's a very common implementation concern. So when you're doing a prescription or when you're doing an imaging workflow, you might actually find that data doesn't mean what you think it means because it's in a different workflow. So when you have a request, well, what is this request for? Is this for me to be aware of or is this for me to act upon? And that might have a different meaning. When you have a, in the good old days, so when we had a prescription and when we'll get there, when we have a thing called the status of a prescription. So I have a prescription. Is it delivered or is it just started? So even in that approach, the model of prescription can actually be something that we now call a request, or can be something that happened to a patient. So the patient had this prescription. So this kind of vocabulary, this kind of exposing the problems that creates lots of issues. So the same thing can have different meanings depending on where it is on the workflow. Of course, it's a patient safety concern. For most of us who have been in a hospital as customers of the hospital, fortunately, we are not very concerned with that, but the likelihood of having issues in healthcare is, as in any industrial process, the likelihood of having issues is actually on the turnover on a workflow, when you had to hand over the work from one entity to the other. One guy starts doing something, the next guy has to finish it. That is the most common cause for errors. There was one institution publishing the top IT concerns several years ago, actually at the time that we started this, and this was one of the focus areas. Workflow is one of the things that is causing us concerns in terms of healthcare management. And finally, we are here about standards. We want to exchange information that must be standardized. So it's hard to standardize workflows because every hospital will work differently, every institution will work differently, every country or region will work differently. We have several operational problems in the US that we don't have in Europe because our operational models are different. We have certain things in one country that are mandatory for workflow, so you don't even need to operate those. Whereas the workflows in other places, they need you to exchange some information that facilitates a specific workflow. We'll get there in a second. So we have to support some variance in processes, but we cannot impose that this is how workflows assume. So if for those of us in Europe, if someone says, for getting a prescription, you first must go to your insurance, check if you're covered, and then you go to the hospital, that is not acceptable. So that's the kind of things that we have to take into account. So we have to do workflows in a way that they are flexible, but they allow us to put some rigidity in each hospital or in each process or care path. We started with what we had, so workflows in V2 and V3. Show of hands, V2, who has done V2? Good. V3? CDAs. Okay. So for those of you who have worked in V2 quite a lot, you know that the workflow is kind of implicit in the way that you expose the information. If you say there is a request or there's an order, then it's obvious that you're ordering something, well, in most cases. There is a scheduling message, there is, so all these messages, they actually define the event, which indicates in which part of the workflow am I supposed to be working on now so that I send this message. So that's functional model, which is materialized by the events in V2, was there. So it requires us to do some gymnastics to make it work for different cases, but it is there. So we have one sender, one or more receivers, which is actually already a problem in V2. You know who's the person that the message is targeted to, so that's supposedly the next person that's going to take the workflow. So the whole order placer, order filler pretty much says, I'm doing this and I want that person to do the next thing. So that makes it easy to handle. What they need to do is instantiated by code, so it's also simple to understand. The results are also hard-coded in the type of message, so if you have an OMP with this event, you have the response is ORP, or you have one of the ordering message types returned. So all of that is pretty much hard-coded in the message itself. And there we go. So the status of this is actually hard to manage. So the status of saying, I'm having this prescription to be filled in, that's clear. But whether the prescription has already been filled in partially or completely, or if the patient has actually taken the medication, that is much harder to follow. So we have to use things like ORC5, ORC25 to add to these things, and it becomes very tricky. I see some smiles there, so that's not only my problem. So workflow on CDA is a completely different approach. CDA is a document, so we say this is what I'm stating. Pretty much, I don't have any concern on who is going to read this. It's not part of this document. I'm stating this. So it's a snapshot of some information at any point in time. So we leave aside the workflow concerns. So there's no delivery mechanism implied in CDA. There is no workflow expectation. So there's no need for action explicit in the document. It might be implicit if you design a workflow next to it, but it can be wrapped. So we have IHE has made profiles to say if you want to follow this kind of workflow, you do this document and then you do this document. So it's explained in documentation, or it can be materialized further in a profile that IHE has called XDW, which is a document that says, after this happens, this must happen and that must happen. So XDW is a profile that, well, it's a document that says where the documents are going. So it's the materialization of the workflow. Still pretty complex if you have to handle this in production environments. So we looked at workflows in other standards, BPMN as the standard way of expressing workflows. BPMN, anyone familiar with BPMN? And we also looked at Oasis Human Task. That was also one standard that was available, just as inspiration to see what we did. And this part is interesting for you that are going to actually implement some workflows. It is interesting to see how HL7 had to resolve or is resolving these things on FHIR, because most of you will actually go through the same experience. You'll have the same questions. So we have requirements for workflow. We have to keep the simple things simple. Like if you just have an order placer, an order filler, if you know that this thing always goes to that place for fulfillment, that is trivial. You don't need to put a big XDW or so construct next to it. You just say, please do tell me when it's done. That's simple. If you have more complex things, you should be able to do that without sacrificing the simplicity of the simple implementations. So you need to say, yes, I can do it. No, I cannot do it. Or you can say, I can do it, but only for a couple of days. or I can do it only half of this because I don't have enough stock, or I can do it only tomorrow because the patient is not here today. So you need to allow some negotiation. You need to see the progress and the status. So if you prescribe something, if you order a treatment, you must see, tell me, you must be able to see, tell me when it's done. So we also have this requirement. Complex status management is, for example, when is the prescription done? Is it when the patient has taken everything? What if the patient doesn't ever take anything? Is the prescription still done after, 1 month that we haven't heard from the patient? Is it after the patient has been cured or has the patient has been has died? Is it when the billing is done? So there's lots of statuses associated with the workflow that we need to take care of. So for the billing guys, they just care about, has it been dispensed? That's it. For the clinical people, it's more, has it been delivered to the patient or has it done its purpose? Has the patient not suffered any allergies from that? Because if the patient has suffered from using the medication, maybe the treatment is not done yet, and maybe I still have to go back on my workflow to still add more things to the workflow. So the complex status management is also important. And of course, we have to allow for changes. In real life, it's not that we will ever have a fully prescripted workflow. We cannot say, this is what's going to happen with this patient from now on. We can say this is what we want to happen, but reality kicks in and we cannot say this is what's going to happen. We have to accommodate for, oh, wait a minute, the patient cannot do this today. Oh, wait, we have to change the contrast because the patient is suffering from kidney failure. We have to accommodate for these things. And this cannot break the workflow. We cannot go back to the drawing board and redesign the workflow there. So on FHIR, we have to do all that and support the paradigms, REST messaging documents. And the first, let's say, the first technical material that we'll see now, if the workflow is to be behaving consistently in FHIR, we have to have consistent resources. So just a short note, we are still pushing it out, so the concepts are very solid. We are still pushing it out, so you might see some changes in the resources in FHIR in the next coming months. It's now pretty much spread out the concepts that we had for workflow. So these same things that we are now going to describe are most likely the things that you will have to see in implementing workflows, and those are now well defined in FHIR. We are now rolling it out to all resources. Let's see what we mean with this. First thing that we did, if we wanted consistency in FHIR, is to define some patterns. The patterns around workflow for the time being are the request, the event, and the definition. So most of the FHIR resources will now fit in one of these patterns. So a medication request is obviously a request. A service request is a request. But the medication request is not an event, is not something that says this has happened. Well, the only thing that has happened is that someone has placed an order for a patient. But it doesn't say the patient has taken the medication. It might say something like, this is done, no need to worry more about this, but it's just the initiation of a process. And the the counterpart to this is the event. So when something gets ordered, we have a request. When something gets done or accepted or promised, then we have the event side. So we have resources that are events, resources that are requests, and actually should be on top of those, we have the definitions. So definition resources are things that define things. There's lots of them here. The more interesting ones for us is the ones that actually define the workflow stuff. So the activity definition, the plan definition, operation definition is more technical, but especially the ones that I would focus now is the plan definition and activity definition. So plan definition is when you say, for a patient that has this kind of condition, first you do this, then you do that, and then you do that. And if that works, then you do this. So this is the plan definition. That's pretty much the workflow definition that we have in FHIR. But that's patient independent, so that's kind of the protocol that we must follow. And then it gets instantiated into the requests and the events, so the resources that we have in FHIR. So we have we have an appointment, we have a care plan, we have a device request, we have a medication request, we have a service request, we have a supply request if we want to. So we have those requests, and we can say if we were just requesting something, those are the ones that we use. If we are tracking on how those things have been implemented, have been executed, we have those events. So in for those of you in V2, those things would be the the message type that is I don't remember which ones. That is the odd number and the even number. So that there's the different messages, the segments. But if you have a request, then you have those things, the request message type, and then the administration of a drug, or the response for someone. That's the event resources. How does request look like? These are patterns. So we have to define the patterns, and then we say these all the resources in FHIR that are request, they should follow this pattern. So we put some basic conditions on the request to ensure that consistency that I mentioned, so that we have, if we have workflows that need to be flexible but support simple cases, we have to follow some patterns. So we say all the requests should have this kind of structure. So the request has some identifiers. It has the instantiates. So, yep. The instantiates is like, which protocol am I following here, or which kind of plan am I following with this request? So if I make a care plan for a patient, I'm actually following maybe this chemotherapy plan, or maybe this medication treatment plan. We have all things like this is based on. So if I make a medication request based on a care plan, so if something includes imaging and then medication and then something else and then lab results, then we say, well, I'm making this medication request based on the previous care plan that I'm acting upon. Replaces, of course, so this request replaces the previous one. So this is a new prescription that the drug is now lower dose because the patient was not tolerating it. So I'm replacing this one with the other one. Group identifier, there is something in V2 there, I don't remember. It's just when you say give this and this and this together, don't forget to give those three drugs together. The status, pretty basic. We'll see the status there. And this, without going too much into all of those, this is the pattern that we follow for all the requests. So we want all the requests to follow this kind of pattern, of logical model. The event, the counterpart of the request has a different structure. So we have what happened, basically, again, an identifier, the based on the part of subject here as well. So the encounter, when did it occur? So the occurrence on the request, you can have this should happen every week. Here is this happened on that week, or this has, you can even say this has happened every week, but this is the actual thing that happened, where it happened, etc., and the performer who has done this this event. The definition, a pattern here. Basically, we say, well, the subject is 0 to 1. We can have a plan definition for one patient if we want to, but more interesting is like the publisher. So things like this publisher derived from description, use context. This is like the national cancer guidelines for this type of treatment, or the current best recommendation at this hospital for taking care of this kind of infection. So this is publishable guidelines that we can support with the definition resources. Feel free to shoot questions if you have interesting cases. One of the go on. One depends on. One event can have, so one request can definitely have more events, and one event can be based on more than one request, yes. If you're doing that, then you might not be in the simple workflow that you just have a send and respond, right? We'll get there. So that's a very interesting question. So we'll get to the point that how do we manage more complex workflows? Yes. Let me see if I answer this question after I go through the task, because I'm not familiar with that part of the scheduled workflow that you mean. So instead of going there into that case, let's see if we have the same question after I go through the task. Is that okay? Yeah. So so request versus task. Request says this needs to be done, and it can be pretty much, I'm saying this patient must have this drug. I don't really need to know who is going to do it, to do this, because it's not my competence, it's not my authority to say which pharmacy is going to fulfill this medication or when is the patient going to be scheduled for a CT scan. I don't need to care about that. So that's just a request. So it means that something should be done on the patient, but it might be actionable, it might not be actionable. There is one case that we'll see next, which is the how do you handle that? The information that the patient has been prescribed this drug, but it's just for you to know. Don't worry with dispensing it, because this, so the patient goes into a hospital, just for you to know that the patient has an active prescription for this blood treatment that he's having. So it's not for the hospital to take care of this medication, it's just for the hospital to know. So we have, that's being a request. The task actually adds one, the most interesting layer on this. So task is pretty much inspired by the human task and by the XTW concepts that helps steer the workflow. Task is like something needs to be done here. So if you have a request, you can say either I'm going to send an event for this and I'm done, or wait a minute, I know that this now needs to be distributed, this now needs to be handled, so I'm going to make a task out of this, or five tasks out of this. Someone says, this needs to be done by that person in that time, etc. So task is taking a request, which is just a piece of paper or a digital document that says this needs to be done, and say this is what someone needs to do now. So taking also the simple example of a medication prescription, if you say I want the patient to have medication for the next 6 months, that's common in hormonal treatments, for example, long-term treatments. That's one paper that the doctor sends or gives away. But then this must mean that, okay, this pharmacy is going to dispense now for 1 month while the patient is in the hospital. After that, the patient must have a continued care by the care support, by the social security or someone that takes care of the patient and must do the other five or six dispenses of this. So it allows us to split the workflow in different parts. So that's what task is about. So task takes something that is just a request and says, let me take this and make this actionable, or steer the actionability of that, if that word exists. And task is also, task has a broader model than the others. So it has pretty much the same key things, the identifier, the based on, the part of, etc. It has a couple of interesting things. So the business status. Business status is, for example, when you say, take the case of a prescription. If a prescription must be billed and delivered to the patient, you can have just one request and one event. Or you can have a lot of things. You can have, just to make it interesting, you can have the billing part. So the billing status is different from the clinical status. You can have the delivery status, which is if the patient is not able to go to the pharmacy themselves, then you can have someone going and picking up the medication for the patient. And picking up the medication is not the same thing as taking the medication. So you can do all the logistics part on Monday, and then the billing can start, but the clinical part is only going to be finished on Friday. So you can have all these variances. And there you have the business status is the one that you say, well, the business status of billing is complete, but the business status of clinical is not yet fully taken. So it allows us to contain the different sets of statuses that we have on the workflow. To make it more concrete, so the request has only limited set of status. The request says, I'm drafting this prescription, or the prescription is active and therefore can be actionable, can be performed by someone. If I decide to suspend it, then I suspend the request and I expect to suspend everything else that follows it. So if I say, please stop this treatment, I'm not saying that it is stopped, because maybe the machines are rolling, maybe the medication has already been delivered to the patient. I'm saying that from my side as a prescriber, I'm stopping the authorization for anything to be done on this. And at the end, we can say it can be completed or it can be cancelled. But that's a very simple status. Anyone that's dealing with state machines for requests for workflows, they will see that it's never this simple. The task allows a lot more statuses. So it says, I'm ready to do it. This is being done. This has just been requested. And we have a status on hold, etc. And we have the business status on top of that. So the workflow execution patterns. With all these basic ingredients, we can actually start saying, how does this work in real life? How can we put this on a server? How can we make sure that this works? So in the workflow page on FHIR, we will see some of these examples. I will just show one basic one and one more complete one. So the basic scenario is, you make a direct post to the filler server and you say, I have a request here, so a prescription, I want to send it out. So I'm a GP, I post it on the central server or in the pharmacy server or whatever server, and that's what I have a post. And when I fulfill that prescription, I say, okay, then I have the event for you. I post the event on your server, on the prescription server, or on the central server again, and that's it. Workflow is closed, workflow is complete. That's the very simple case. Questions on this? Clear enough? Relatable? Go on. We are, yeah, so I was hoping to get it to the end, but let me open the door for that. The task allows to say, this must be done. And what is this? It can actually be another request or can be another task. So you can have tasks comprised of tasks, which is typically the case. You can have a dispense task. You don't care at that moment how much subtasks that's going to imply. You don't care. You just delegate that whole task to someone else. And you can still have one status just for the dispense, because you have the business status to say, someone is going to do this, they are going to update me on that, but I'm keeping track of that task. And if above me I have a higher level task, I can also update that. So it's, as Keith was saying, it's turtles all the way down. You can prioritize the tasks. You can say, this must be done. You can say, this must not be done. So there's also some exclusions or conditions on the task. You can say, if this happens, please don't do that. So you can do all that sort of constructs in the tasks and manage the handover. So task is not really only to address the complexity of the processes. For that, we have plan definition. That's a very comprehensive resource. It says, this is what might happen. Task is to track the execution of this, to say, if I have this request, so I'm now delegating this, Mr. X or Nurse Y, please execute on this. And if you need to sub-delegate, you can create subtasks and still ask for things. This is very common in lab, for example. So this is a simple case. The more complicated case is when you really don't know and don't care who is going to act on this. In a simple case, because I want to go to even more fun stuff, if you have a placer that says, I just need this to be executed, I don't really know or need to know who is going to perform this, you put this on a FHIR server that has a sort of a workflow broker. So someone that says, if I get a prescription and I know exactly what to do in this hospital about this, I know if I need to validate it, if I need to start filling it, if I fill it completely or just for every day of that the patient is here, and then I create more and more tasks, one task per day to remind myself of doing this. So this is a more comprehensive scenario. And you have, the placer puts this on the workflow server, the workflow server creates tasks for this, and those tasks can be directly assigned or picked up by the filler. So you can say, this task is for the pharmacy, or you can say, this task is for someone, and then the pharmacy says, oh, there's an open task, I can subscribe to it. So it's all up for grabs, it's all up for implementers to say, do we want to have a direct workflow mandate, or say we want to imply that this person must do that, or we say this must be done. I don't say who is going to do it, but this is the task list for today, and someone can subscribe to it, and people can take the tasks. And this is where the plan definition comes in. So the plan definition says, if you want to know what to do after each prescription, there is a document, a FHIR resource that says, sorry, this is what needs to be done. So a workflow definition can be, as I said before, a workflow, a standard procedure. So this is like the guidelines, you see, for this treatment, for this infection, for this kind of procedure, this is the typical actions that you do. Like if the cell count for whatever type is above this level, then you must do this. All sort of conditionality can be put there. This is where we define it, not where we instantiate. We instantiate with the task. And there is one interesting thing coming up now or soon, which is the workflow conformance. We want to say, if I send this this resource first as a request, I need that kind of resource later. So currently, with the way that we are profiling FHIR, we say, this is what should be in a prescription, this should be in a dispense. But we don't yet have a place to say, if a prescription is of this type of profile, has this profile, then the dispense should be in this type of profile. So if a prescription has some mandatory field, etc., there might be some conditions that you follow on the dispense or the administration side. So we are also working on that. Familiar with IHE people? IHE? Yeah, so this is where the IHE transactions come in. So IHE transactions are pretty much, if you do this, this must be the next step. So very briefly, we had, after we did this, so after we applied this theory to our patterns, we said we will do this on the resources. So we started mapping the resources to these patterns. So we had some changes. I will not go through these. But basically, we said to the committees, please try to follow these patterns. If not, you please explain why you don't follow this. So this, before going to the example scenario, this allows us to say, instead of saying, I use a prescription as a broad thing that I can track the status, we say, no, prescription is an order, is a request, therefore it stays on the request space. And most resources are that, is either a request or a event. So that's what we kind of enforced. That was voluntary, people were adopting it voluntarily in FHIR resources. We want this to be less and less, have less and less variance, so we will follow up on that as well. But we can expect that FHIR resources will follow this. And we also had one cool thing, that's what I wanted to follow, to check. We also made, for those of you who are designing things and want to explain things in a simple way, we had the example scenario resource. So for those of you in the FHIR committees, those discussions are happening since 2016, and we have those discussions, so please join. So we have some plans to put this in place. And one of the things that we'll do is to have people explain the workflows that they do in each of the committees, like the medication, the patient care, etc. They should be visible in a way that we have scenarios. So very briefly, and I think we are getting close to the end of our time, suppose we have these scenarios. Pharmacy gets sent two prescriptions. One of them is to say, please do this, or please dispense this medication. The other one is not, it's just for you to know. So if you have the approach of order placer and order filler, this gets very tricky. So remember that we said FHIR should make simple things simple and not overly complicated. So in this case, we actually don't need a task. We also added a tag in the meta of the resource that you can say this resource is actionable. So you can tag this resource is actionable, this one is not actionable. So that's a simple way to get out of this. We can tag resources as requests as actionable versus not actionable, which has an issue because if you don't have a tag, you don't know if someone forgot to put a tag or they were not required to put a tag, or if you are really not supposed to act upon it. So that's one way of addressing this. The other one, the other scenario is, suppose you have the nurse that goes out, very common here in the Netherlands, the nurse goes out and does the shift to take care of several patients in home care. What does she do? She takes the list of medications to administer today, and then she does the rounds. So she gives medications to the patients, and then she reports back to the people. So this is actually the example scenario that we were talking about. So if we have this scenario, maybe we need tasks, maybe we don't need tasks, but what we want to show is that people that are doing the profiling and people that are doing the specifications, they have now this possibility to make a thing called the example scenario, which is another FHIR resource that you say, if I do this first, then I do that, then that happens, and this is the resource. So we made an example scenario, and we are working on this kind of visualization and representation that's going to be part of the FHIR publishing things. So if you have in the core build and in the implementation guides, if you make examples, you'll have the examples page. But if you have an example scenario, we are working on to get this kind of diagrams for people to follow on. So it's very easy to do things like, let me just show it to you. So this is actually it. So if we have, this is the workflow. I just want to show to my customers that if you click on here, or if you do this, you can click here and see what is the actual outcome. Or let me show another one. Let me see if this shows up. If I go here, then I would have the request for administration. I don't know if it will show. Yeah, I'm working on local. Sorry for this. But normally you would actually see the JSON file showing up there. So this is a navigation tool that we are using. We are putting it in the build, as I said. And this allows us to explain both the simple cases, which is pretty much two arrows, please do, done, or all those sorts of arrows that this goes to the workflow broker must first consult the plan definition and then must create a task and create another task and delegate the task to those people. It's much more powerful to visualize this and to tell people what's happening. And it actually forces us as implementers and designers to say, am I really sure what content am I going to put there, or I know I'm going to put a medication administration and that's it. It actually forces us, by putting this on the build, it actually forces us to say, oh, I must really put concrete examples here that really work, and that's what we are enforcing. For this, just as a final note, we'll have the example scenario builder in one of our tools, so the FHIR toolkit. I don't know when Graham will release it. Hopefully soon we'll have this tool there. I just had one example somewhere there, but you can expect this to be part of the core build and the implementation guide build. Okay, I'm asked to cut the session. So I'm thanking you very much for your attendance, for the questions. And join Zulip if you haven't done so. Thank you very much.